Good morning students, I am Aushman Prasad and creator of this channel Digital Generation. This channel is regarding chapter wise preparation for both ICSE and CBSE students. I hope you will get best knowledge and explanation from this channel. Respiration in human beings. Like all other land animals, human beings are also air breathers. And lungs are the main organ of respiration. So the mode of respiration in human being is pulmonary respiration. The parts which are associated with respiratory systems are nostrils or nasal cavity. The two holes that are present at the tip of the nose are known as nostrils, and these nostrils internally leads to nasal cavity. The main function of nasal cavity is filtration, and this is possible only because of the presence of minute hair-like structure called cilia and mucus, which is secreted by the nasal bone. This trap the dust, pollens and other pollutants of air and filter it. Apart from filtration, the other function of nasal cavity is warming and humidification, which prevents the dryness of the respiratory membranes. Buccal cavity or oral cavity also serves as a secondary opening for respiratory tract. But the step downs are that there is no humidification, no temperature regulation and no filtration, but still it has one advantage. Buccal cavity or oral cavity has a wider opening and thus it helps in greater intake of air. Then comes pharynx, pharynx or throat. This is a muscular structure and is a spacious chamber. It is about 5 inches long. Pharynx receives both buccal cavity and nasal cavity. Pharynx leads to both trachea and esophagus. The opening of the trachea is known as glottis. Normally the trachea remains open, but during swallowing of food, trachea is covered by a cartilaginous lid known as epiglottis. Next come larynx or voice box. Larynx is a cartilaginous structure and it leads to trachea. Larynx is also known as Adam's apple. Larynx contains vocal cord and thus it helps in speaking. Larynx is present at the top of the trachea. Next come trachea or windpipe. Trachea is a hollow tubular structure. It starts from pharynx and it ends in middle of the thoracic cavity. Trachea serves as a passage for entry and exit of respiratory gases. At the end, the trachea is divided into two branches, which are known as bronchi. Each bronchus enters into lungs of its own side. These trachea and bronchi are supported by C-shaped cartilaginous rings. These C-shaped cartilaginous rings prevents trachea and bronchi from getting collapsed when negative pressure is developed during inhalation. Then comes lungs or pulmonary sacs. There are two balloon-like structures on either side of the heart and is present in the middle of the thoracic cavity. These are called lungs. Lungs is covered by a membrane known as pleura. Pleura is divided into two layers. The outer layer is known as parietal pleura and inner layer is known as visceral pleura. The right lung is bigger in size than the left lung. The right lung is divided into three lobes known as right superior, right middle and right inferior, whereas the left lung is divided into two lobes known as left superior and left inferior. Each bronchus, when enters into lung, divide and re-divide to form secondary and tertiary bronchioles. Internally, inside the lungs, these bronchioles divide and re-divide to form conducting bronchioles. From the name conducting bronchiole, it suggests that there is no exchange of gases in these conducting bronchioles because the wall of the conducting bronchioles are very thick. Then these conducting bronchioles again divide and re-divide 20 times to form respiratory bronchioles. These bronchioles have thin wall, and here in these respiratory bronchioles, gases exchange may take place partially. Each respiratory bronchioles then divide 5 times to form alveolar duct, and each duct then ends into a balloon-like structure known as alveolus. There are hundreds of millions of alveoli present in each lungs. This process of dividing and re-dividing of bronchioles leads to increase of surface area for exchange of gases. The area of alveoli that are present in lung extend from 36 to 72 square meter. So there is a huge surface area for the exchange of gases. These alveoli have very thin wall and thus helps in the exchange of gases. These alveoli are highly vascular, that is, they are richly supplied with network of capillaries. These fine capillaries also have thin wall. Alveoli also has thin membrane. Thus, diffusion of gases takes place between alveoli and the blood capillary because of the close proximity of alveoli and blood capillary. Now comes ribs, intercostal muscles and diaphragm. In human beings, there are 12 pairs of ribs. These ribs are bony cartilaginous structures. One end of the rib is attached to the vertebral column, whereas the other end is attached to the sternum or breastbone. 10 pairs of ribs are attached to the sternum or breastbone. 2 pairs of ribs are free and they are known as floating ribs. So there are 12 pairs of ribs in human beings. These ribs forms a cage-like structure which is known as rib cage. Inside this rib cage is present heart and lungs. These ribs protects heart and lungs from hemorrhage. Intercostal muscles. The muscles that is present between the rib are known as intercostal muscles. Intercostal muscles are very helpful in process of respiration because the contraction and relaxation of these intercostal muscles helps in the movement of the rib cage. For example, when this intercostal muscle contracts, then the rib cage elevates. That is, the rib cage move up and outward, thus increasing the thoracic cavity. Similarly, when the intercostal muscle relax, then the rib cage move inward and downward, decreasing the volume of the thoracic cavity. Now comes diaphragm. Diaphragm is a muscular flap which separates the thoracic cavity from the abdominal cavity. It is made up of fibrous tissue and normally diaphragm is dome in shape. Diaphragm helps in the mechanism of breathing by increasing the volume of the lungs. For example, when the diaphragm contracts, that is, it becomes flattened, then the thoracic cavity increases in volume and as such the lungs also increases in volume. Similarly, when the diaphragm contracts, then it contracts the lungs and thus the volume of the lungs decreases. Now we will study about the mechanism of breathing. Breathing is an involuntary process and it occurs automatically. But the rate of breathing can be controlled by the center of the brain. So first we must know what is rate of breathing. The number of time a person breathes in a minute is known as rate of breathing. And this rate of breathing is different in different animals. One breath means one inhalation and one exhalation. Breathing involves two processes, intake of oxygen which is known as inspiration or inhalation and elimination of carbon dioxide which is known as expiration or exhalation. Now we will study one by one about the process inhalation and exhalation. Inhalation. In inhalation, the intercostal muscle and the diaphragm contracts and so the rib cage elevates and it moves up and outward. As the diaphragm contracts, the thoracic cavity and the lungs also increases in volume as it becomes flattened. Now the volume of the lungs increases in all directions, up, outward and downward. Now according to Boyle's law, P1 V1 is equal to P2 V2. When volume increases, then pressure decreases. So when the volume of the lungs increases, then the pressure inside the lungs decreases. That is, the pressure becomes negative here. 758 millimeter of mercury of pressure is now present in the lungs when the lungs is increased in volume. So a negative pressure is created inside the lungs, whereas the atmospheric pressure outside the body is 760 millimeter of mercury. So air from the atmosphere rushes inside the lungs, and when this air enters into the lungs, then the alveoli that are present all becomes inflattened. That is, they become filled with oxygen. Now this atmospheric oxygen contains high concentration of oxygen, about 20.08%, and low concentration of carbon dioxide, about 0.04% of carbon dioxide. So when the alveoli get inflattened, then they are filled with air. These alveoli are surrounded by network of capillaries. This network of capillaries bring deoxygenated blood from the right side of the heart. As the blood in the capillaries are deoxygenated, so the percentage of carbon dioxide is high, that is 4%, and percentage of oxygen is low, that is 16%. When the alveoli are filled with gases, then diffusion of gases takes place between the alveoli and the network of capillaries. Because the difference of concentration of gases between alveoli and blood capillaries. As there is high percentage of oxygen in alveoli chamber, so oxygen from alveolar chamber enters into blood capillaries via alveolar pore by diffusion. And again, carbon dioxide from blood capillaries diffuses into alveolar chamber. Now, when oxygen enters into the blood capillaries from the alveoli, then blood capillaries contains RBCs and in RBCs is present hemoglobin. So oxygen which diffuses from the alveolar chamber into the blood capillary combines with this oxygen and forms oxyhemoglobin. So oxygen is carried to the blood in the form of oxyhemoglobin, and this oxygenated blood then reaches to the left side of the heart via pulmonary vent, and then from there it is pumped into various parts of the body. When oxygen diffuses into the blood capillaries from the alveolar chamber, there is a change of color from bluish purple to red color. This indicates that this is oxygenated blood. Actually, the blood never becomes blue, but we demark deoxygenated blood blue color and oxygenated blood as red color to make the difference between oxygenated and deoxygenated blood. Oxygen combines with the hemoglobin present in the RBCs and changes into red color. Now this is called oxygenated blood. Now let's see the fate of carbon dioxide. Blood capillaries contains higher concentration of carbon dioxide. So carbon dioxide from blood capillary diffuses into alveolar chamber. Carbon dioxide is transported by bloodstream. Carbon dioxide is soluble in water and thus it is dissolved in plasma and is transported in the form of carbonic acid or carbonate ions. Now this carbon dioxide from blood capillary enters into the alveolar chamber. This is the part of inhalation. Now we will study about exhalation. After the diffusion of gases, exhalation process takes place. During exhalations, the diaphragm as well as the intercostal muscles relax. As the diaphragm relax, it reaches to its normal dome position, so it contracts the lungs and the volume of the lungs decreases. Similarly, when the intercostal muscle relax, it leads to the inward and downward movement of the ribcage, and as such the thoracic cavity as well as the volume of the lungs decreases in volume. As the volume is decreases inside the lung, according to Boyle's law again, P1V1 is equal to P2V2, when volume decreases, pressure increases, so inside the lung the pressure has increased. It is about 762 millimeter of mercury, whereas the outside pressure or atmospheric pressure is 760 millimeter of mercury. As the pressure is high inside the lungs than the outside pressure, so air from the lungs is expelled out through trachea and nostrils. When we expel air, then carbon dioxide is also eliminated along with the exhalation. This way inhalation and exhalation continues together. Thank you for watching my video, and if you find my video useful, please do like and share my video and subscribe my channel to get the latest update of my videos. And if you have any doubt regarding this chapter, comment below. I will try to answer as early as possible.